The statement that got most attention was his comment that the US and other countries should mind their own business and not attempt to approach China's periphery. And this was pretty controversial because the approaches that he was talking about had generated two near misses between China's military and the US military in the 48 hours before General Lee was speaking to this audience in Singapore, as you mentioned, at the Shangri-La dialogue. And those incidents, both of them, occurred in international waters and international airspace. So rather than expressing any sense of alarm or concern, General Lee, his advice was, mind your own business. And he actually said, can I just point out to you, do you think it's peculiar that all of these incidents, and other governments too, by the way, Bev, raised this problem of dangerous and unprofessional tactics by Chinese pilots and Chinese ship captains. Canada was uncharacteristically strident about this at the Shangri-La dialogue. Their defense minister, Anita Anand, was accused China of disruptive and dangerous tactics and near misses. So this was a theme running with multiple countries, not just the US. And General Lee's response was, don't you think it's peculiar that this is all happening near China? And what does that tell you? He said, that tells you that you guys should mind your own business.
And you see, this is what is so confusing, because he, on one hand, says the US and China, it would be a disaster if we ended up going to war, that we can talk this through, that there is place for both of us. But they constantly redefine international waters to be China's, international airspace to be China's. So the two sides are very far apart.
Yes. So on exactly that dichotomy, shall we call it, there's a euphemism for it, we heard a number of Chinese interlocutors at the Shangri-La dialogue, including the Minister for Defence, General Li, talking about the need for negotiation, how China is prepared always to negotiate differences, to find solutions and find win-win outcomes, and that China is negotiating, in fact, with the 10 nation states of ASEAN, Southeast Asian nations, over a code of conduct by their militaries in the South China Sea to prevent incidents. Some of the speakers from other countries, notably Vietnam and the Philippines, pointed out that those negotiations have been underway for 20 years, that China refuses to negotiate with the ASEAN group en bloc and insists on bilateral negotiations with each country. In other words, China is deliberately allowing the absence of a code of conduct to prevail because it doesn't want one. And that's just a classic example of the same phenomenon where Chinese government representatives talk about wanting to avoid clashes, conflicts, and misunderstandings, and yet seem prepared to accept the continuation of clashes, near misses, and dangerous encounters in the air and on the sea, not just with the US, not just with the Canadians, with all the ASEANs with whom it has territorial clashes, and there are five of those at least. And it was just a year ago, just last year, Bev, I'd just remind you that Australia, the Australian military had two near misses where Australia complained to Beijing about dangerous and unprofessional conduct by Chinese pilots and ships captains. And in one case, an Australian surveillance plane was not only buzzed by a Chinese military plane, but you might recall the Chinese actually released tiny bits of aluminium chaff near the Australian plane, which of course is extremely dangerous and invites a disaster.
Yeah. Is China, you know, as you say, talking about wanting dialogue but not accepting meetings at high levels, but is this a deliberate tactic, from what you've been able to glean, to really keep this whole situation off balance so that they, in the end, get their own way?
So the official talking points from Beijing would say, no, of course not. We are very sincere in wanting to prevent escalation of incidents and misunderstandings. However, on that exact point, I'd offer three things. One is that a hotline that was established between the two militaries has since been allowed to go defunct on the Beijing end, but that's between Beijing and Washington. Two is that the US at this very meeting, the Shangri-La dialogue on the weekend just passed in Singapore, the Pentagon had asked a month in advance for the Chinese minister, the new minister for defense, to meet the US defense secretary at Shangri-La. It's been used in the past as a neutral meeting ground for the two great powers. And a few days before the dialogue, the Chinese side came out and said General Li would not meet Lloyd Austin, his counterpart, even though the two of them were in the same building for the weekend. They met, sat across from each other at dinner and shook hands, but the Chinese side refused to allow any substantive contact. The third thing I'd add, Bev, is something that a very senior US official told me a while ago about the nature of these dangerous incidents in the air and on the sea between the US and Chinese militaries. This official told me that this has been the case for some time. The US had been requesting talks to set up protocols to manage such incidents and guardrails to keep them contained from escalating into a conflict or, heaven forbid, a war. And the US official said to me, he'd said to a Chinese counterpart, why won't you agree to these protocols? And his response that came back to him from a Beijing official was, you are asking us for seat belts. We are not going to give you seat belts. In other words, the Chinese message was, these are risky encounters. We want to keep them risky. We want to put you, as you said, Bev, off guard, on the back foot, wary of danger. In other words, this is part of the continuous pressure tactics which Beijing operates to force its claims on other countries. It's used the same tactics, uses the same tactics week in and week out with Japan, with Taiwan, lately with the Philippines, Vietnam, and now we see it doing the same with the US.
Yeah.
To pull these countries out of international waters and international airspace to suit China's expansionist ambitions.
Good to talk as always, Peter. Thanks so much.
Pleasure, Bill.